Hello, everyone. I'd like to take a few minutes now to speak about an absolutely fascinating moment in 16th century history. It's a controversy that erupted over the persecution of Jews in the Italian port city of Ancona, which was blown up into a major controversy between two differing Jewish perspectives on how to react to the burning of 25 Jews at the stake. One group of Jews, led by Dona Gracia Mendes Nasi, felt that an international boycott of that port should be organized, and in fact she did so from her new home in Constantinople. And this mobilized, for the first time in history, Jewish economic power on an international level to try and demonstrate Jewish will and effect some positive change for Jews in international circumstances. Another school, however, that was personified by another very powerful woman, Benvenida Abravanel, argued that no, this was the wrong approach to take to this horrific act, and she argued against a boycott. So we're going to come to discuss the boycott itself, but first, to understand, you know, how this came to be, we have to go back to the Iberian Peninsula and understand some of the roots of the conflict between these two women that were really an expression of the differing experience between two different populations that originated in Spain and Portugal. So there, I have a lot more lectures on the experience of Jews in Spain and Portugal, but I'm just going to summarize very quickly here. In 1390, there was a wave of riots that spread across the Iberian Peninsula and resulted in tens of thousands of forced baptisms of Jews. This was actually in contravention to traditional church law, which forbade the forcible conversion of Jews. But the fact is, by the theology of the time at any rate, once they were converted to Christianity, they could not revert to their Jewish status without committing an act of heresy. And so what this meant was you had two different populations of Jews in Spain at the time. You had those Jews who had not been forcibly baptized. Let's just call them Jews. And then you had another group of Jews who had been unwillingly brought into the fold of the Catholic Church, who did not want to be there. So, and we'll call them, let's say, crypto-Jews or conversos. They were often called new Christians to distinguish them from old Christians who were not of Jewish background. And the derogatory term used was Marrano, which means swine. Obviously, we're not going to use that term. So these conversos had an unusual kind of situation because they still identified themselves as Jewish, although they were freed of all the legal disabilities that accrued to being of that faith. They were free to enter universities, they were free to ply whatever trade they wanted, they were free to reside wherever they wanted, and within several decades, these conversos began to penetrate very high levels of Spanish society, and began to be felt very strongly in the Spanish economy, no longer being forced to pay the discriminatory taxes and other restrictions that were placed on them as a result of their Jewish origins. So by 1478, the crown decided that the Inquisition would be created or brought into Spain, and that the Inquisition was directed at this latter group of Jews. In other words, the Inquisition was not directed at Jews per se, who were never exposed to the baptismal font. Rather, it was directed at those conversos who had been forcibly converted and were now, so to speak, backsliding and still associating with the Jewish community. The Inquisition used these horrible methods of, you know, sudden arrest and torture and forced confessions and a cycle of purging that turned the entire peninsula upside down. Society was devastated by it. And so by the end of the 15th century, the decision was made that the reason why the conversos were not, you know, hewing to the party line is because they were still in contact with regular Jews. And so the Inquisition drew its attention to the Jewish community of Spain, convincing, as you see in this classic image here, the Queen and King of Spain, Isabella and Ferdinand, to expel the Jews in 1492. This resulted in a massive dispersion of Jews throughout the Mediterranean basin, the coast of North Africa, up into European countries. Amsterdam in particular was a destination, and of course into the New World. The Inquisition, however, did not stop there, and in fact, it continued to be active anywhere where Jews were found, and the ongoing arrests and torture and forced confessions and ultimately the auto da fe, the burning at the stake, as you see, for example, in this particular image, continued well into the following centuries. And in fact, the Inquisition itself was not disbanded until the 19th century. So this brings us to the port of Ancona. Ancona is located here on the Adriatic Sea. Nearby is Pesaro, another port, but not nearly as high quality. Ancona is a deep water port that allows ships, large ships, to get much closer to shore, and it was well established as a maritime mercantile center, and many Jews lived there and plied their trade. And there were actually two different populations that were there. There were the so-called Spanish Jews, and this term is used because they had fled Spain in 1492 with the expulsions. There were also a community of so-called Portuguese Jews, and the Portuguese Jews are also originally Spanish Jews, but they typically had made their way into Portugal in 1492, where they lived in a rather tenuous situation until 1497, when they were all forcibly baptized as well. Many of them eventually managed to escape Portugal, and once they were further away from the peninsula itself, they began to re-identify with Jews, and they rejoined the Jewish community. And in Ancona, there was a fairly liberal attitude towards them that was largely a result of the activity of Pope Paul III, shown here. Pope Paul was not an enthusiastic backer of the persecution of Jews through the Inquisition, and as a result, he turned a blind eye to the presence of this Portuguese Jewish community, that is, new Christian community living in Ancona. His successor, however, Paul IV, was not so inclined to positively regard the Jews in Ancona, and as a result, he imposed a series of anti-Semitic legislation, beginning with this bull called Cum Nimis Absurdum, which is a Latin phrase that preceded the document, which essentially said, since it is absurd that converted Christians continue to go back to their Jewish roots, he imposed a whole series of regulations against Jews, including the establishment of the ghetto in Rome, the requirement to wear yellow clothing, all kinds of things like that. And in Ancona, he had 25 of these Portuguese Jews arrested and then burned at the stake. One of them actually committed suicide before the sentence could be carried out. This was considered a huge offense to the Jewish community. They were living in peace in Ancona, and one woman in particular was not willing to simply let it go. This is Dona Gracia Mendes. This is, of course, not a this is not a contemporary picture of her, but it's an artist's rendition of her. I think it's very, it conveys some of the mood associated with this rather heroic individual. She was a Portuguese Jew who had fled the Spain. Her family had fled Spain and made their way into Portugal. They had been converted to Christianity, as all the Jews living in Portugal at the time were. And then eventually, when she got out, she reclaimed her Jewish identity. Like many Portuguese Jews, she made her way to the Muslim Ottoman Empire, where they are welcomed with open arms, and she made her home in Constantinople. There, she ended up becoming an extremely powerful and wealthy woman, and she decided to use her strengths to defend the reputation of Jews worldwide by standing up to the Pope himself. And she called for this international boycott of Ancona. Hundreds of Jewish merchants up and down the Adriatic coast were affected, and they rallied to her side and said that they would, in fact, agree not to use the port of Ancona anymore, which would cripple trade in that region, and instead they would use the nearby port of Pesaro, where many of the Portuguese Jews had fled and had attempted to establish a new maritime industry there, or at least revive the industry there that was not nearly as strong. Benvenida Abravanel, on the other hand, we don't have a picture of her either, but this is an amazing portrait of one of her students. She opposed the boycott of Ancona for several reasons. First of all, it would have a negative impact on the first Jewish community of Ancona, the native Italian Jews of Ancona, that is, those Jews who were never baptized like the Portuguese migrants were. Let us recall that she herself was of a Spanish derivation. She was a Spanish Jew. Of course, the last name, you may recognize it. She was a niece of the great Don Yitzchak Abravanel, also known as the Abarbanel, a very important statesman and Torah scholar. And she argued that if we were the Jewish community, if we were to impose such a boycott on Ancona, then that would have negative repercussions on many other Jewish communities under papal control. And so she argued against it. She also said, by the way, who says that Pesaro is going to be any better? There's an incredibly nasty episode associated with the Duke of Urbino, who was responsible for Pesaro, where under his rule, there was an anti-Semitic attack on a local synagogue that actually involved the desecration of Torah scrolls and the dressing of a pig in the Torah mantle, and then the pig was then placed in the Aron Kodesh, in the Holy Ark. So she said that Gracia Mendes, although they had some respect for each other, she disagreed very strongly with her and said that a boycott should not be mounted. In the end, the boycott, after several months, fell apart because of the opposition of those who felt that Benvenita's position was stronger, and ultimately it was not able to have an impact on the Pope and his anti-Semitic decrees. Nevertheless, we see here that for the very first time, Jews are willing to flex their economic muscle on an international scale for the benefit of Jews in other countries. That's a fascinating thing to think about, and also fascinating to see that it was two powerful Jewish women who brought this about. Okay, that's it for a very quick video. I hope you found it useful, and I hope to see you, God willing, if you're in town, on Monday night in Brooklyn. Thank you for listening.